Okay, maybe I start. Yeah, so this will be a series of four lectures following lectures of Pierre Shapiro and Masaki Kashiwara, but it will be on slightly related subject. Yeah, so the rough plan, it will be four lectures. Today we'll speak about finite dimensional exponential integrals. Then second lecture will be about one-forms and wall-crossing structures. And then third and fourth will be infinite dimensional story and applications to quantization, non-perturbative quantization. Yeah, so this, it will be quite different talks, and I think it will be quite entertaining to see the relations in the story. So I'll start with kind of first integral which everybody knows. Which is Gaussian integral, which is square root of pi. Yeah. Yeah, and somehow I want to generalize this integral and calculate relative things. Or more general, what we can integrate. Let's say we integrate still in one variable. We have f of x, g of x, dx. We integrate such thing. We're what? Where f is maybe some constant times x to the power of d plus some lower terms is a polynomial which is given. So it's, for example, in this example, it's minus x squared. And now g is also a polynomial which is arbitrary. We write g, and it can have any degree. Here, maybe I assume that d is at least 2. And I should integrate over some path, yeah? So some path p. And what will be a good path? Path will be, let's say, in C will be oriented semi-algebraic path. Semi-algebraic, I mean real semi-algebraic, like real line or can by some real equation, polynomial equation, and such that real part of f is sticking to path when we go to infinity. As we go to infinity in C, real part will go to minus infinity. So the integral should be somehow convergent. So we have many such integrals, but claim that one has to calculate if you vary both g and path. We have many integrals, but really interesting integrals are you have only d minus 1 squared, kind of integrals to compute, and the rest will be given by some linear combinations. Yes, and this thing depends somehow on homology class of path and cohomology class of this form.
So the path is where? On just
in C.
In C?
Yeah.
So this.
Yeah. Yeah. First of all, about path. The integral depends only on homology class.
Not enough to convert to minus infinity. You can make a path where the convergence is sufficiently low that is not.
No, but path is semi-algebraic. I said the path is semi-algebraic, and that's it's not semi-analytic. And then automatically the integral will be convergent because in some local coordinates, function will grow like. Fractional power of small parameter.
Okay.
Yeah. and the integral will be absolutely convergent. Yeah, so the so it depends on non-homology class of path. Maybe it's called gamma, which is homology class of the path, and where it lies. It's an element of first homology group of the pair C, and I consider subset f minus 1 of maybe I'll just draw what I draw. I draw the set of points in C such that real part of Z is less than minus t, and t is I assume that t is a very large real number. Maybe take it with integer coefficients. Yeah, this homology group is free group of rank d minus 1, with d is degree of my polynomial. Yeah, just for example, if my function is minus x square, as it's kind of the basic example, then what we should draw, we have a C, when we consider domain when minus x square has very negative real part, we get just two pieces, and we can connect them. This gives a homology class. Yeah, this homology group stabilizes when t is very large, so I mean just in any one of them. And if, for example, if degree of if d frankable is 5, you should get the picture like this. You have in C, you get, depending on coefficients of your polynomial, you get maybe 5 domains where real part goes to infinity. And as the basis of homology, you can choose maybe choose some, put some orientation. That's an example of the basis of homology of the pair. Now, so you get essentially d minus 1 interesting path. And what about g? This function g. Let's consider, maybe I just put it on the blackboard. We consider twisted Durham complex. Which in this case is the following. We consider in degree 0, it's just polynomials in x and goes by df to c of x, which dx, where df is differential plus wedge product with df. So if you look how looks on some polynomial, consider some polynomial g. G goes to what? It goes to g prime derivative of g plus f prime times g times dx. That's how this twisted Durham differential acts. And why I wrote it? Because if you multiply by exponent of f, it will be kind of isomorphism, and do it here and here. You just consider expressions which are polynomials on x times exponent, and polynomials of x times exponent times df, kind of one forms. This will be just usual differential. Yeah, so it's just a way to write it algebraically without referring to exponential function. And the integral, again, depends only on cohomology class of g dx, maybe. Yeah, maybe g wasn't, sorry, it's maybe should put some another letter because it's not g, maybe h. So g dx defined modulo the image of this differential. And cohomology, so the cohomology of this complex are only in 1 degree. So here there's no kernel. So that's only a kernel. So this class of g dx belongs to each one of this complex, of this twisted Durham complex, which is the same in this case. It's co-kernel of df. So it's, I just write the definition. I'm more doubt by the image of this map. And this space is actually, again, finite dimensional, it's isomorphic to CD to power D minus 1. And the basis given by representatives of 1 times dx, x times dx, x to power D minus 2 times dx. Yeah, it's very easy to calculate that. Yeah, for example, for D equal 2, you just write how this twisted drum complex looks like. So 1 goes to maybe and function maybe minus x square minus 2x. X goes to so you get such formula, and it's clear that you can kill top degree terms and reduce to constant here. Only constants you cannot appear get the image of the differential. Yeah, so that's the kind of basic example, generalizing this first story. And now I'll go to general setup. So it will have several ingredients. So first I'll have smooth algebraic variety over complex numbers. Let's have certain dimension n. Then I will have some extra ingredient which wasn't present before. I will have closed algebraic subset. Of smaller dimension, maybe singular. Then I get a function. I can write it in various words, like map from X to affine line or complex numbers. It's kind of polynomial map. Or equivalently, F is section of the structure shift on my variety. Then I should have some volume form, which is a top degree algebraic form. It's kind of top degree algebraic form. And I need something which will be something like denoted by C, chain of integration. I'll explain it in a second. But before going on, I have to explain why I should introduce this set D. So it's kind of why I have this extra set D. Because there are other integrals which work can similar to what we have. Yeah, for example, one can have this guy. And D will be something which contains the boundary of integration. Or I can have another integral which is the things, I think it's called something like E1 of t. It's not elementary function, and it's this is called exponential integral. In fact, this guy is called this exponential integral. It's not elementary function, and for example, in this case, what will be variety? In this case, variety will be a affine line. This d will be divisor, just one point. T function is minus x, and form is dx over x. Yeah, so it's a kind of integrate exponential function times volume.
Volume on what? On x?
On x, yeah.
But it's holomorphic.
But x is not it's not compact. Ah, sorry, x1 minus 0, sorry, you're right. Yeah, x is and t maybe is positive number here.
So the idea is that your path necessarily is n either at infinity or at
It's some sub-variety, yeah. Yeah, it's n as at infinity or at some point t, which is in this case algebraic sub-variety of C star.
Okay. In general, you have to integrate over n-dimensional paths.
Yeah, and no, it's a chain. It's not a path.
Chain.
Yeah, it's chain. Yeah, in this case, it's chain of integrations. It will be n-dimensional. Yeah. Someone should be a bit careful about chain. What will be this chain? The chain will be the following. It will be some be kind of sum over n n I c I, some finite sum. V c I is oriented n-dimensional semi-algebraic submanifold in.
Submanifold, you mean compact, or it has?
No, it has boundary. It could.
Ah, it has boundary. Is it smooth after the boundary, or?
No. It's open part. It's open, kind of open. It will be open.
In general, when you consider simplexes, maps of a simplex.
I consider interior. I consider interior of simplex, like interior of simplex.
Okay.
Real semi-algebraic submanifold in n x with the property and such thing has its kind of rectifiable set. It has natural boundary, and I assume that the boundary of support of the differential is in D. Yeah, and the second thing which I assume is the following. If consider real part of f as a function with values in real numbers and restrict to the closure of support and restrict to the let's support to C, which will be just union of this different sub-varieties. Then it's a map from to R. Has two properties. Is bounded from above. So it means that this real part of F is less than some, on the support is less than some constant. And second, this map is proper. And if you get such a situation, one can integrate of a chain this expression, and this integral will be absolutely convergent, and that's generalization of this one-dimensional story.
So for the regularity, can it be enough to have so-called sub-analytic also?
Maybe, yeah, but it really doesn't matter. I will in 1 minute we'll go to some cohomology group, so this exact chains will be relative. Yeah, globally, yeah, on some computation, yeah. So now I want to say what does it mean, homology class of the path. It belongs to what? Yeah, I want to describe relevant homology theory called gamma. So first of all, define certain set S sitting in this kind of set for F and the pair. That's the meaning of this set. It will be some finite subset in C. It's finite. And what's the definition of the subset? It's informal. It's a point when topology changes of the fiber. More precisely, define what is the complement of the set. So I say that Z is not bifurcation value. Is by definition the following: there exists an open neighborhood U of point Z. U is just in C, which is kind of R2. So there is an open neighborhood, and plus such that over this my neighborhood, my vibration is with x to C is locally trivial. So there is a homeomorphism between the pullback and U times F minus 1 of Z. Compatible with projection to U. So this diagram is commutative. So I kind of trivialize topologically my bundle, such that these things also trivialize a restriction to the subset D, inducing homeomorphism of what? Of intersection with preimage with D, with U intersecting which is kind of subset here. So it means that the thing is locally trivial. I claim that this happens for all points except finitely many. Why it's so? So the explanation: one should compactify X, so the map will be expanded to the map from compactification to P1, then to some algebraic variety containing X, and then X prime minus X will be some vertical part, which is F minus 1 infinity union some horizontal part, which is some another subvariety. So you get some kind of, also you have our things D. So there are algebraic variety with many, many things inside. Three devices inside, and when it projects, we know that topology of everything is locally constant except some finitely many points. So you get this finite set of bad values, and now what is cohomology group? One can consider the following. Various cohomology groups, which will be all isomorphic to each other. First, I consider H, consider cohomology of X, this is subset D, and union of F inverse again, the same story as before with integer coefficients, where minus t is less than real part of any zi, where s is the i's are elements of my this critical values. If I consider pre-image truncate the things, it still doesn't depend on t. There's a natural map from one t to another, and they are all isomorphism because you get all homotopy equivalences. And if all isomorphic to each other. Also, one can, and also it's isomorphic to the same thing, but I take preimage not of a half plane, but any point in the half plane. And Z, where a real part of Z is less than real part of Zi for any Zi and Z. It's again, you just consider preimage of one point, because one point is not to be equivalent to half plane, so. Isomorphism. And so I get many, many groups which are isomorphic to each other and call all of them just by one word. Called HB dot will be degree on cohomology. HB of pair X, D, and F. And B is for kind of Betti. It means it's kind of usual topology, not the risky topology. That's how Dolin denote. And so the class of gamma, so this gamma, which is class of C, is belongs to H, maybe a variety of some dimension n, yeah, middle dimensional. Okay, so we generalize the homology class of the path, and now we should do something with the form. And it's completely similar, so I use twisted Durham complex again. So I have df, d plus which product by df. And it gives me a differential on, it gives me complex of sheaves. Go one next, df. But this complex of sheaves, now I should be very careful, I should do it in the risky topology. So I consider only algebraic forms and covering by algebraic open sets and so on. So the one can define twisted Durham cohomology of pair. Is the following. So now I have pair. Just a second, I think I need my one assumption, assume that D is divisor with normal crossing. I said that it should be divisor with normal crossing. It's in general, it could be singular space. Actually, it's not not a restriction at all, because you can blow up. Yeah, you can make blow up and replace by divisor with normal crossing. It doesn't change any cohomology which we consider at all.
But the twisted Durham will change.
Yeah, no, but cohomology of twisted Durham will. Twisted Durham I defined only for normal crossing, and it doesn't depend on resolution. Or maybe you can.
You define it relative to D.
Relative to D, yeah. I consider form vanishing on on D. If D is singular, I will be a bit unconfident. Not logarithmic, forms vanishing on D.
Bound vanishing, in which sense vanishing?
Restriction to D is zero. Yes, yes, yeah. Restriction to each component of D is zero, yeah. Yeah, so I consider, so it contains a subcomplex. This is differential df, where omega is d, forms whose restriction and d is a union of some divisors, smooth components, restriction to each di is equal to zero. Yeah, and this things I think I defined as hypercohomology in the risky topology of this complex of shifts. And I claim that the integral is actually can be so first of all, if you get this is my form, which I have volume form. If I have an n, in fact, it also belongs to, because it's top degree form, it's vanish on divisor D automatically. And also we have d of volume form is zero because there's no n plus one form, it's top degree form, and df, which volume form is zero. So it's killed by differential global section, so it definitely gives a class in this hypercohomology. And what I want to say is that exponential integral, which we're interested in, is actually pairing. Is a pairing between homology classes. So I get class of chain and class of volume. And the pairing maps with BT homology, XDF. H DRAM.
C. Is it true that those are actually dual over C?
Yes. Yeah, they are dual over C. Yeah. There is comparison isomorphism that's dual space, kind of Betti cohomology after quantification isomorphic to DRAM cohomology. Yeah.
And this comparison isomorphism can be so with the without reference to those chains, so that's why
I'm not sure. It's
so like the RAM theorem is shift theoretic, yes?
Yeah, one can prove it shifts theoretically. Yeah, it's following what we listened last week's. Yeah, it's, it also gives a proof. Yeah, essentially it was I think it's actually it was proven maybe first by Malgrange, this comparison isomorphism. I'm not sure.
Yeah. Why do you pick the risky?
Yes. No, if consider cohomology in not in the risky topology, you get just cohomology of a pair XF because you multiply by exponent of function, you identify with usual forms. Yeah, so it's completely wrong for if you put analytic topology.
But you could also compactify and take forms
neuromorphic. I will speak about how we calculate it using compactification and stuff. It will take some time, but Now, till the break, I will now speak about kind of topological part on the Betti set. So, for a moment, we forget about this hypercohomology and this thing. Maybe I'll even kind of hide it, not to see too much. First thing we want to say is some kind of Poincaré duality. I go to this picture. I assume I have the following situation. I get x prime, some smooth compact variety, compact algebraic variety over C, which contains three three divisors, horizontal, vertical, and some closure of my D. This will be normal crossing divisor. And I assume that this will be union of some different components. So different three things, these things has no common components. I have such thing, variety with three divisors. And assume that D bar intersecting between DH is empty. And I have a map from, I think, to CP1. Just a map. And D vertical is preimage of infinity. Set theoretically, yeah. It could give you some multiplicity, which I don't care. In the moment, and how it's related is original story x x prime. I remove divisor d horizontal and d vertical. D will be d minus intersection of d vertical. And f is a bar restricted to x. Now, so you get such a situation. So let me draw the picture. It's a bit hard to follow. Just use various colors. Yeah, so I get CP1, I get point infinity, and here it's my x bar. I have some device that is not crossing d vertical, which goes to infinity. Then I get something will be, d bar, and have another thing which is completely transversal. It should be d horizontal. So what happens? I remove this. I think remove d horizontal and take pair relative to d.
So the condition that d bar intersection d horizontal is empty, this seems to be a constraint relative to the situation that you considered before.
No. It's not a constraint. That can be always achieved by making additional blow-ups. Because my chain doesn't really touch d infinity. If they intersect, I can blow up the intersection, and chain will not touch this.
And then you have to change the x somehow.
I change a little bit the x. Yeah, it's true. No, but to have kind of clean cohomology theory, I really want to have such.
But the previous comparison theorem, I mean, the setup in which you have this comparison theorem between different homologies, this kind of the
arms. So this does not include this hypothesis. I mean, the, when you have a situation in which this comparison isomorphism is true, it's not necessarily the case that you can compactify to.
It's true, but I think you are right. But one can at least numbers can reduce to larger situation. I want to say that at least in this situation, what is this Poincaré duality? I have this thing, and so I can define also Betti cohomology by using cohomology of pairs. All rational numbers are dual cohomology, and the claim is that if consider homology of original thing, it's naturally isomorphic to cohomology after shift of some new variety minus f, and maybe shift by two times dimension. And what is the new variety? You just exchange the role of these two divisors. You remove one divisor, get pair relative to another, or vice versa. So x prime will be this is the complement, but now I just remove instead of d union d vertical, and d prime will be just. So I get different homology group, and let me briefly say what the origin of this Poincaré duality. First, you consider kind of common open part you remove from x bar all three divisors. Consider the complement. You get some open manifold, and then because it's you have a divisor normal crossing, one can add some boundary with corners. Can add a real boundary and get manifold with corners using polar coordinates and things which. Clear? So you get essentially closed manifold. And if one analyze all these pairs, one can do something on the boundary, and eventually maybe I'll just draw the picture. What happens? You have some kind of compactification, kind of real manifold, real compact manifold with boundary, and also with corners. And then the boundary of this guy, which is again manifold with corners, one can decompose, one can put some negative part plus maybe some middle part plus positive part, and roughly the picture like this. You get some two disjoint open domains with in the boundary, and the middle you get something like color, so it will be is a cylinder, and then you get usual Poincaré duality, so cohomology of pair x0 and d minus x0 is dual to cohomology of x0 d plus x0. Yeah, so one can do analysis like this, but there is some interesting point. Why I replace function by minus function? Because when I do this domains in a boundary, what I do roughly as I can imagine a kind of complexified sieves sphere at infinity, a circle at infinity with the values of my function. And instead of minus infinity plus infinity, I take two angular domains and take pullback, and you see that it really looks like two domains which you connect by a color. And the same goes to high dimension.
Why? So you said the boundary is the union of d minus d plus and other things?
And other things which is something which you added to d minus, which will be contractible to d, maybe something like homeomorphic to the product of whatever, n minus two dimension, some manifold small dimension times the interval.
And this comes from the divisors, from different components?
Yes, one can, make. Yeah, of course one can do it in different languages using shifts and so on, but so. Same story, yeah. Yeah, no, so the main thing is this objects allow duality. That's one thing which I want to say. But now, before the break, I want to spend some time with some very basic topology question. About topology of the map from a pair, you get X in pair D and maps to C. Because it will be topology, I think C will just think it's a real plane. And we forget about complexification story, just do something very basic. So suppose I get a map from a pair to R2. And I define bifurcation set as before, as a complement to the points when it's locally trivial, topologically locally trivial, and assume it's finite. But now x and d will be for me very general. For x and d will be, let's say, just topological spaces. I ignore all details of this story. And then I fix integer number. And I claim that in this case I can construct a constructible sheaf. On C. And what is the fiber of the sheaf? Fiber of X, where X is at point Z, where Z is any point in C, is defined as a stock at point C, is defined as case cohomology of the pair X, take D, and take union of the preimage, not of the point Z, but a small disk. With some simple Z-integer coefficients, where epsilon z is a set of z prime in C, z is less than epsilon, open disk. And this, by this finiteness condition, we see that it stabilizes as epsilon goes to zero. So we identify all of them. Yeah, so the claim, it's a constructible sheaf. So obviously, if we're outside of ramification points, then it's local system, because we have locally trivial bundle. Outside, we get structure local system. And what is the structure of a sheaf?
Finite rank.
Sorry?
Finite rank.
I don't assume anything It could be, in our case it's finite, but in general it's very, very general story. It's the main point is this is finiteness. That's what plays for me essential role, nothing else. It's a constructible sheaf. And what's the structure of a sheaf? Just define just a collection of abelian groups, and one should kind of make a translation. Suppose I have a critical kind of critical this bad point when I have ramification. Then what should I do? What should I do? So let's draw kind of I take point Z I, take preimage of this disk in union with some set, and take cohomology of pair. But now if I have point very close to Z prime, I can have kind of smaller thing. This you see the d epsilon zi, or what is whatever u zi epsilon minus point zi can contain some u, some another prime, maybe z, some epsilon prime. Z is not z prime, and epsilon is more than. It's much smaller. Then I can have a restriction map from cohomology of pair to cohomology of pair. And that gives you sheaf structure. So I have for a section, for the stock of my sheaf at this point, I have stocks in nearby points. This is exactly the definition what is a constructible sheaf. Yeah, so I get constructible sheaf, which is smooth outside of S. And kind of the theorem, which is not obvious at all, that this sheaf has a zero cohomology. So there's no global sections, no first cohomology. In fact, there's no higher group, or we can say this R gamma f is equal to zero. And here it's a very, very bizarre story goes on. You will see it in a moment. It doesn't really, it's not really part of homological algebra, so I speak about cohomology. So what is the explanation of this fact? It goes through some different formalism. Let's consider the following pairs. We have pair D and B. Consider pair D and B, where D is, let's say, in C is a closed subset, and which is homeomorphic to closed disk. To the closed disk. This curly D will be some, or maybe not homeomorphic, I'll say, maybe piecewise. Whatever you want, linear analytics, infinity. This could be maybe has some corners. And D is a subset of C. B is a point on the boundary of D. And we have only one constraint. Constraint that there's no bad point from the set of my set on the boundary. So this bad points which I have, there will be some inside, some outside, and here I get point B in my disk.
What kind of regularity you have? You avoid some spikes or some?
Yeah, it doesn't really matter. One can use semi-analytic, semi-algebraic stuff. Yeah, it's just to avoid horrible singularity. And for any such thing, I can associate a abelian group which I denote something like by A of this pair of D and B, which is a case cohomology of the pair, the following. I take image of disk and take again D intersecting with preimage of disk union F minus 1 of B and take homology with integer coefficients. I have this cohomology of pair. Yeah, so this and they form the following thing. This A, if I search this association of the disk and point on a boundary, is a local system on space of disk is boundary such that boundary disk do not touch. So I allow to move my thing, but boundary shouldn't cross this red point, this S.
What is D? D is that in your other space, okay.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, it's some infinite dimensional space, but this should form a local system. Then we have such thing. Then we get restriction maps. If one disk contains another, and B is equal to B prime, is the same point, then we get a map from A of DB to A of D prime B. And it's again locally constant map. If we deform both things. Yeah, so what happens here, get this D, I get D prime, and some bad points stay in one, some in both of them, some outside. And because I have just a map of pairs, I just get restriction to a smaller space. That's clear. And then it satisfies some kind of additivity axiom. Namely, imagine the situation like this. I have D, and maybe I just make a little bit smaller. D contain D prime and union D double prime. And there's no point, no black points, no bad points in the middle. So there are some points here, here, outside. So D is a big disk contains two small disks. Yeah, all points will be marked points will be the same. Then the additivity property says the following.
That's the condition about the thing in the greater that we said, isn't
that? No. I said that D. D and D minus D prime intersecting with S is equal to D. I put this condition. And D is kind of something, some disk containing.
D is not the, it contains the union, no?
Yeah, it's not, yeah, and there's maybe disjoint here. It's point B. They touch at one point. Then what I have in this station, by restriction maps, I get a map from AD. B maps to AD prime B plus AD double prime. D.
So you take D minus the union or D minus the intersection?
Sorry? D minus the intersection? D, the union, sorry. Sorry, yeah, you're right. Yeah. By restriction maps, I get a map from to one group to another group. I get a map to direct sum. And this thing is isomorphism. Yeah, so I get this different types of structure, which I have in this situation. So what is the relation of this to my sheaf, to constructible sheaf F? The relations is the following. If Z is in C minus S, the stock of my sheaf can be written as one of the spaces, namely DB, when you have the following picture. Here B will be Z. And D contains S. There are many such disks. You choose any one of them, and you define this like this. It's not really a definition, because then you should say how you identify one thing to another. It's a pretty complicated story. But and similar story if Z belongs to S, one of these special points. Then you should draw the following picture. You should make you should just exclude point Zi. That will be point B. And all the rest will be inside. Yeah, that's the definition what F of Zi is, A of such thing. So what if you look on this axiomatics that I get groups depending on disks and some restriction maps and additivity axioms, it works. So axiomatics works if we replace the cohomology of pairs with some integer coefficients, with some given, for given any k, by any contravariant functor called it H, from what? From topological spaces. Or pairs, because pairs can be replaced by topological spaces with base point by contracting clause 6 to 0. Topological spaces with base point to groups or even to any abelian category. It doesn't have to be groups. It's a contravariant functor. It's up to homotopy. But it doesn't shouldn't be some cohomology theory. It has only one property. If you have two spaces, I don't know, some space y1 and y2 with base point and y2, then have the union where you identify kind of bouquet. You identify the base point. Of course, it contains both y1 and y2 with some base points. And then we have a map and this should be isomorphism. So it's definitely any cohomology theory like K theory, Bordisms, or cohomology with certain coefficients works, but maybe there's some kind of bizarre, I don't know, functors on homotopy types which do not come from cohomology theory, because I just sit in only in one degree. So I don't do things like suspension. Then one can repeat the same procedure and get a constructible sheaf with R gamma equal to 0.
Should be, what is right there? Should be isomorphism.
Isomorphism, yeah. make a break maybe in 10 minutes.
Yes, sir.
It's not clear at all. It cannot deduce this from homological algebra. Just give you some kind of theorem, which we proved with Katsarkov and Pantev what 7 years ago. It's just kind of fixed finite set CTQ2. Oh, see, that's really meta. Then the following things are equivalent. This category of constructible shifts of, let's say, of abelian groups. Which are local system on the complement to S. And such that there's no H0 and H1. Yeah, that's one condition. Then it's equivalent to the following data, to the following things. It's equivalent to collection of the abelian groups ADB. Boundary B intersecting with S is empty, which form a local system on the space of parameters D and B, plus restriction maps. As I explained before, here, satisfying the additivity axiom. And third thing is something very explicit. Maybe I'll very, very explicit. So this third description choose some topological data a priori, choose some kind of DIBI, such that DI interior of DI contains only ZI and no other. So for each point in my set, so for each point I choose a small disk containing and choose a base point on it, and also choose for any ordered pair of indices which are different, choose a simple path. And I'll draw the picture. And the simple path, say, should go from start from some point. So I have map from interval to R2. So 0 goes to point of my first disk, but not point bi. 1 goes to point bj, and the interval goes to R2 minus union of all disks dk for my of all points. It doesn't intersect all. So I draw this path outside of my points. So I just make this choice, but not everything. It's, for example, it should be something like. Sorry?
The disks.
Disk are disjoint. Yeah, I assume that also di I'm missing this. My prime is empty. This collection of paths, it could be not arbitrary. I don't. For example, I can choose of something called Gabriel of type. What does it mean? I kind of imagine that I have some point z infinity which is very far from my point zi, and kind of first connect by disjoint part pass to all zi. There's no disk yet, but now what I do, I just I have this bi di. I just draw small little disk and have first intersection point to the point bi. But now how do I connect them? It's let me just. Yeah, there are two possibilities. I go from up or to down, and one should choose a path something like point in my set.
So you want something which is topologically equivalent to such a thing, or what?
Yeah, topologically equivalent to such a thing, yeah. You get just collection of things, you get collection of invertible maps. So there's this inverse from each guy to itself, and collection of maps Tij from Ui to Ij. For I non equal to j, so to think no further constraints.
But what you do there is not, I didn't understand the principle, so because you have different choices.
It's A and could be j, maybe first and maybe j second.
Ah, you start from one I.
And you want to reach another disk, but it could be above or below in this picture.
And if you have more.
Ah, no, it's many of them. It's maybe some intermediate here, which I didn't draw. Yeah, I have many disks, but they form ordered set.
Yes.
And if I go from one to another, from which I start could be below to the result or above. And according to this picture, I use different.
Ah, but do you have a path from I to J and a path from J to I?
Yes, yeah, it's ordered pair. Ordered pair.
And the paths could intersect each other.
They can intersect. So this is just it's really long story how it goes. I just want to explain you, and I'll explain it in different terms in my later further lectures. What is TII? What is space UI? Ui is exactly this A D I B I. This is definition of spaces Ui. Then what is TII? You consider if you have a disk. Wait a second. What? Somebody's call. Ah, okay. Yeah. You consider one parameter family of pairs disks with marked points. You just travel your point around the boundary of the disk. And you make, because of our constraints, it's kind of local system, you get automorphism of this space Ui. And what is Tij? Just a second. So we get for I and you get something for j. And what I just finish in 1 minute. You have a pass. Now I draw again, consider one parameter family of disk with marked points, which will start with the following thing. It will be, the marked points will be always bi. I start with this, then the intermediate step will be something like this, and the final step will be again get one parameter family of disk with marked points. And what happens here, so I get some kind of, again, disk depending on, disk depending on parameter theta, some angle along this variable. And so what I get AD0, maybe BI, by monodromy along the path, or holonomy along the path. It's identified as d maybe 2 pi, the same pi. Then both of them map by restriction map, because both contains original disks, a di bi. And also both of them are isomorphic by axiom to the direct sum. It's also isomorphic to direct sum. And one can check that the matrix, when I have, so I get isomorphism of the space to itself, and the matrix will be identity zero here, because this one is quotient object, and some operator which will be by definition Tij. Yeah, that's a definition of operator Tij. So it's a really long story, but if I choose, if one gets this explicit data, one can explicitly construct a sheaf which has R gamma is equal to zero, and the whole thing does depends on description. And so eventually we see that R gamma is equal to zero. It's a kind of calculational result. It's not follows from abstract homological algebra reasons. One can choose different passes. In fact, if no three points lie on the same line, one can choose kind of straight passes between disks and maybe rotate a little bit these things. Yeah, so in general, what kind of collection of passes you can choose to have this equivalence, I don't know. It's kind of interesting question of topology about braid groups. So now we have small break for maybe 10 minutes. Yeah. So before I talk to you a lot about this topological, how topology looks like. So eventually it's very simple data, but depends on this drawing. And now about Hodge theory. So all this thing which you consider x, d, and f is a generalization of just smooth variety and divisor, say, with normal crossing. But variety is not compact. And in what sense of generalization, we just consider usual algebraic geometry, it's a part when f is equal to zero. Then if we consider h diram x df, it's kind of generalization of diram cohomology of pair, when there's no function, we don't have this correction to differential. So if you try to think it's about Hodge theory, this is cohomology of pair. It's a typical example of mixed Hodge structure. It's not enough to consider just open varieties. You really consider pairs to get interesting Hodge mixed Hodge structures. And pure case correspond to usually that when D is empty, and also X is compact. Yeah. And what is analogy of pure case in the case of function? Kind of analogous to pure situation is when D is empty, but F is proper. In fact, it's very common situation at, that is proper. Often when D is empty, but F is not proper, there exists a compactification or partial compactification X tilde contains X and F tilde goes to C is proper, such that complement, say again, is kind of horizontal, is divisible with normal crossing, and F tilde restricted to any, and let's say it's union of some d alpha of any intersection, is vibration. So topology at infinity doesn't change. That's a kind of really nice situation. In this situation, first of all, see that critical points of F is the same as critical points of F tilde. It's automatically belongs to X. And then whatever cohomology of pair for X and F is the same as cohomology of X tilde F tilde, and the same is the RAM and comparison isomorphism. So one can kind of get non-proper situation can replace by proper without changing anything. And yeah, it's a very concrete example. I can just say the following. Suppose X is C star square with coordinates, let's say, x1, x2. And the map is goes to x some Laurent polynomial on C star square. Then the generic fiber is elliptic curve minus 3 points. And even singular fiber, singular elliptic curve minus 3 points. You just add 3 points to the fiber and compactify the fiber. So x tilde will be x, and you add 3 copies of C. Compactify it somehow, and this things became now proper map and without changing topology. Yeah, and such things are really very convenient. Instead of this proper map, you can consider these things which are equivalent to proper, have the same cohomology. And for example, we can make kind of tame polynomials. Even, for example, take X is C and F is X square. In the case of one dimension, this is really no problem. But what is the advantage? Such things call XE kind of is a singular at infinity if there exists X tilde satisfying all this property. And if you get these things, one is a singular at infinity, and you have another thing with is a singular at infinity, you can make a tensor product. And here will be some kind of Thom-Sebastiani sum, so it will be kind of pre-image of F1 plus pre-image of F2. And just take the things. Is a singular. Yeah, so in sense it's proper kind of pure Hodge whatever analog of pure Hodge structures, one can really multiply and just take product. Yeah, it's just some sad remark that it's very common. Yeah, there is something called tame polynomial. For example, people sometimes consider x just cn, and you get f as some polynomial. Yes. And for good polynomials, you can compactify fibers uniformly without changing topology. And so reduced to this pure case. Yeah. Yeah, but now I assume that it's assume D is empty and F proper. I can do the following. I consider some H bar will be parameter, Planck constant. For any Planck constant, I associate H dirham, depending on Planck constant, on X and F. There's no divisor, skip it from notation. And just by definition, it will be hypercohomology of X is the risky topology. You take forms with differential h bar d plus df. Yeah, so the claim is the following. So this this form, this collection of h dirham h xf, this forms an algebraic vector bundle on plane C with h bar coordinates. And for each degree, endowed with it has a meromorphic connection, natural meromorphic connection with pole at h bar equal to zero, and irregular singularity in general here, and regular singularity at infinity. No other singular points. So you get a connection, and the connection has second order pole at h bar equal to zero. It's kind of first fact that it's vector bundle. Essentially says it's rank of h bar equal to zero. It's this doesn't jump. It's our old result with Sergei Baranikov, which was proven several times, and I will explain the proof in next lecture of more general result. It's analog of degeneration of Hodge-Dirham spectral sequence. And this allows to speak as about the fact that the connection has second order pole, because otherwise you don't have canonical notion of trivialization. So what's the origin of this connection? For h bar non equal to zero, one get covariantly constant integer lattice in this cohomology, kind of gamma h sitting to h. And in fact, it's to describe connections better to describe this lattice. The reason is the following. You see that this thing is isomorphic to Dirham cohomology of d plus df divided by h bar. Namely, isomorphism is you multiply ih times the degree of form. you kind of rescale complex, and you replace by this complex. And then here by comparison isomorphism. So it's h deram of x and f divided by h bar. And then it's isomorphic to h beta of x f divided by h bar tensoring C. And the image of this six will be a lattice gamma h. Gives a lattice, and lattice gives you a connection. There will be a unique connection preserving this lattice. So the non-trivial thing to check its lattice, this has, I think, has a really second order pole. First thing is, if you consider connection over go to Laurent series in variable h bar, and you allow poles, then it will be isomorphic to the following thing, to direct sum over all critical values of my function. You take exponent of zi divided by h bar as a kind of generator of d module in h bar variable, tensoring some regular holonomic d module over this formal Laurent series. And this part, if considered regular holonomic d module over Laurent series, is the same as vector spaces plus automorphism. And in fact, what is this vector space in this automorphism? We consider cohomology of kind of beta cohomology of a neighborhood of maybe f minus 1 of zi with coefficients with shift of vanishing functions, of vanishing cycles. A function in shift by zi, so it will be value 0. And this is abelian group with automorphism, and it gives regular holonomic d modules. And this is, I think, it's maybe Saito and Claude Sabayev. It was actually my question a few years ago, and it was the answer that it's this holonomic d module is canonical isomorphic to this guy. Okay, then there are things which I probably will not explain right now. The Stokes filtration at h bar equal to 0 in any direction, is compatible with lattice structure. So there are several statements here. If you also go to form power series, but without inverting variable h bar, then it's canonically isomorphic to a direct sum over all critical points. And you take cohomology of formal or maybe analytic neighborhood or analytic or algebraic neighborhood of what? You consider the things and intersect with critical set of F, called it's maybe kind of capital Zi of Zi. It could be very singular subset, an algebraic subset of my X, but you take arbitrary neighborhood. And a neighborhood, I consider forms, now add formal parameter and take again hd plus df, the same differential. Yeah, so I can calculate it, calculate these things locally. And what else I want to say? Maybe a couple of points here, that fiber at zero is naturally isomorphic sum over I, cohomology again of neighborhood of the I, is complex of forms with differential just multiplication by df, and it's isomorphic to cohomology of X with the risky topology with df, and isomorphic cohomology of X with analytic topology with the same thing.
So formal, you don't take the algebraic formal completion, yes?
Yes, yes.
And the analytic, you don't, do you mean complex analytic?
Complex analytic.
But then you have to take, you take formal or convergent power series?
No, still formal. Yeah, in H bar it will be formal power series. Yeah, in fact.
So when you take analytic, is the fixed or the limit of all neighborhoods?
For any given neighborhood, yeah. It was pretty complicated story here. I think it's all of them are isomorphic. Whatever you do. And maybe what the last point here get. And also get kind of non-degenerate pairing. Essentially, this Poincaré pairing, which I explained to you before, between H and RAM H bar XF is isomorphic to H. Maybe take dual and RAM minus H bar XF, because it's for h bar not equal to zero, we get up to shift, we get this pairing which I explained before. It extends to non-degenerate pairing at h bar equal to zero. Yeah, so we get this. Picture. I will not really. This is kind of analog of Hodge theory, and let me explain in a second why it's analog. That can be thought as an analog of Hodge theory. What here really goes on? For h bar non equal to zero, we already get this notion and no trouble at all. What happens if we remove zero? Consider tensor remove zero, obtain, get. Irregular holonomic D module on C star with coordinate H bar, which has irregular singularity at H bar equal to zero, and regular at H goes to zero, and regular at H bar goes to infinity. Yeah. But now one can make the following thing. Let's introduce inverse variable, call it T. So we get D module on C star is T, which get vector bundle with connection, algebraic connection. But now it has irregular singularity as T goes to infinity, and irregular as T goes to zero. And D module of the thing, it means that you have an action of T inverse and D or dt. Satisfying usual commutation relations. But this D-module, we can interpret as D-module over C. Just forget that T is invertible. And the same is D-module on C, this variable T, such that T gives multiplication by T gives is invertible operator. It's just the same story.
Plus some regularity condition.
Yeah, again the same regularity condition, yeah, which we have here. Plus the same regularity condition. And such thing, so it's and then this thing's used by Fourier transform. So Fourier transform, it means that T goes to d or dz, with z is some dual variables, and d or dt goes to minus z. Okay? And we get d module on c with z coordinates, such that d or dz is invertible.
Plus some regularity.
But this D-module will be will have regular singularity everywhere, and then what?
You mean regular
everywhere, including infinity. And this D-module has regular singularity including infinity. Then it gives a by Riemann-Hilbert correspondence. Gives a perverse shift on C, such that R gamma of the shift is equal to zero. Because how we calculate the Ramp cohomology? We get a module, kind of d module over this invariable z. And when you calculate the Ramp cohomology, you just consider m tensoring O by O, m tensoring O by forms. And to get the Ramp differential, you just act by d or dz and consider kernel and co-kernel of these things. Here, so the Ramp cohomology is kernel and co-kernel of d or dz acting on this total space of a model. And because it's invertible, it means that its R gamma of corresponding constructible shift is zero. And this is exactly this shift which I explained to you before.
What is O?
Functions on polynomial functions in one variable. So you see that it's so it's eventually it's equivalent to this topological data which I have before to have these things. And so if you just throw away zero, you get the same topological data just rephrased in a different way. And extension to h bar equal to zero, it's kind of analog of Hodge filtration. That's where Hodge structure appears. One can treat the very simple case when f equal to zero. And if you follow the line, then h deram h equal to zero of x f equal to zero will be direct sum of hp of x omega q. It will be a direct sum of cohomology forms. And for h non equals zero, you get the Ramp cohomology. And how we glue one thing to another, it's using Hodge filtration. Because it's well known things, for example, filtered spaces are the same as C star covariant bundles. And you get essentially this this picture. What I want to say is that, it looks that all these things can be extend to general case if x bar is contains this d vertical using d horizontal plus d bar. I have the three things and I really want this property. As before, and I get f bar from my extension to p1. Then what one should do, one should consider on x bar minus d vertical, we consider things like this. We consider forms which vanish, whose restriction to d bar is zero, and are logarithmic forms with respect to d horizontal. And we have this shift, and we endowed with differential h d plus df. Take our gamma. And this again form, at least I hope, form a vector bundle as h bar goes to 0. And the same story works. Yeah. So just
on x bar d, I don't understand. Where is x bar minus dv?
Ah, minus d vertical. Yeah, sorry. Yeah, sorry. You're right. You can see the forms vanish.
Oh, it's easy to see it's a vector bundle outside the horizontal.
Yeah, because it's the same. You have topological description, and homology of pair, then jump. Yeah. But h bar to 0, I think it's the spectral sequence again degenerates. But in principle, it should be part of more general things about.
So this is a generalization of the previous.
Yes, I think it should work even for general mixed Hodge modules. So let me formulate the general story. There is some kind of notion of things called mixed Hodge modules. It's by Saito. So it's if you have, but these mixed Hodge modules could, and very interesting mixed Hodge model on a fine line. See, it's algebraic variety, not an analytic one. What is it? It's constructible sheaf. It's perverse sheaf. Of Z modules, which correspond to some things with regular singularities, corresponding D module with regular singularities. And it should care something like Hodge filtration. It will be vector bundle with connection to some delta functions. Yeah, so there's some kind of notion here.
And you require regular singularities everywhere?
Everywhere, including infinity, yeah. And so we get some category of mixed Hodge modules, and contains part, which denoted by something like this. Those such that R gamma of constructible sheaf is 0. And
is it a Q-sheaf or a Z-sheaf?
Z-sheaf, say, yeah. Yeah, or maybe Q-sheaf. Yeah, maybe a
different perverse structure.
Maybe to Q-sheaf, yeah. Forget about torsion. It's not terribly good. Yeah, and this is a rigid tensor category. Where you use convolution, additive convolution, to make the tensor product. Yeah, actually, this perverse shift will be automatically constructible shifts sitting in degree one. It follows from this condition. Yeah, there is some simple result that in case of one variable, it's automatically just sits in 1 degree. And there is some kind of weight filtrations here. Yeah, so there is one can make analog of weight filtration story, which we developed with Jan Soebelman for some auxiliary reasons. So this can complete parallel to usual story. And maybe I stop here and continue next week. Thank you.